coming is to his defense, speaking to our Dana Bash.
Has he paid federal income taxes over the last 18 years, yes or no?
Of course, yes, absolutely.
Have you seen your father's income taxes?
Yeah, I don't study your tax returns. That's why you have
a... But have you seen them?
Of course you see tax returns.
No, have you seen your father's tax returns?
I'm answering the question. Of course I've seen my father's tax returns.
Now, questions about Trump's taxes, of course, have been swirling since the New York Times reported that he declared a $915 million loss in 1995. But that did not stop him from living big and lavishly, frankly. Jessica Schneider is out front.
To hear Donald Trump tell it, his business was back and better than ever at the end of 1994.
I think it's the best year I've ever had. Trump is definitely back.
Trump invited cameras to get a glimpse of his revamped Mar-a-Lago resort in this December 1994 interview. But only a year later, he declared a $916 million loss for reasons unknown on his 1995 state tax returns, documents revealed by the New York Times. The loss may have allowed Trump to legally skip paying federal income taxes for years, but despite that nearly billion-dollar loss that could have been accumulated over years, including 1994, the year Trump claimed was better than ever, the real estate mogul was still in a buying mood.
I could have billions of dollars in debt, but I also had billions of dollars in assets.
At Mar-a-Lago, Trump's Florida estate, he paid nearly $2 million at the end of 1993 to buy an adjacent home to his empire, according to the Palm Beach Post. We searched public records and found, more than 2,000 miles away in Colorado, deeds from San Miguel County show Trump purchased three lots near Telluride for $1.1 million in March 1994. Attorney Alan Pomerantz led the negotiations between Trump and more than 70 banks in the early 90s, when Trump was on the brink of personal bankruptcy, and he says Trump had a penchant for purchases.
How would you describe his spending habits?
Lavish.
Pomerantz says at the beginning of 1990, Trump owed a combined $4 billion to dozens of banks, and about $800 million was personally guaranteed from his own assets. It was a grim reality Trump laughed off a few years later in 1994.
I was walking down Fifth Avenue, and I said to Molly, "You see that man over there?" And it was a man who was a beggar in front of Tiffany. I said, "He's worth $900 million more than me."
Trump's admittedly dire financial straits didn't stop the Trump Organization from securing a $4 million mortgage for a Bedford, New York estate in Westchester at the end of 1995, or from getting a $10 million loan to purchase 40 Wall Street in Lower Manhattan in 1996, according to New York City public records. Real estate investment expert David Eisenberg says Trump's reported loss on his tax returns didn't stymie his spending power.
Tax losses sometimes have nothing to do with cash flow, and he was living the lifestyle that he was accustomed to.
I mean, living the lifestyle he was accustomed to and doing it through more debt.
Exactly. You know, Donald Trump has repeatedly declared that he is the king of debt. This summer he tweeted about it, saying that he made a fortune off of his debt, that debt made him a great businessman, but in those same tweets, saying that he would actually fix the debt of this nation, so we'll see.
Certainly a man who's built his fortune on debt and leverage and getting rid of it. All right, thank you so much. Pretty incredible to see that. Well, Trump's loss it seems huge, right, when you're talking about $1 billion. But where does it really rank? Like, what are the facts? It sounds big, is it? Well, Tom Foreman joins me now. He has put this number into perspective, which is the crucial perspective we need, Tom. So how unusual is it, $916 million?
It's pretty unusual. Hard to imagine anyone surviving that kind of loss and moving forward. In fact, an expert with the Tax Foundation told the Wall Street Journal, this represented almost 2% of all the net operating losses for businesses that year, 1995, in the United States. Another way of looking at it, you would have to gather together more than 9,000 other average businesses and put all of their losses together to equal how much Trump lost that year. So, how did he survive this? Well, one of the things may be that there are unique laws at play to real estate people that don't apply to everybody else, and that may have played a role here. These deductions for real estate professionals are written into the tax code. Among the things that these tax code provisions provide is the ability for people to function a little bit as an individual and as a company simultaneously in terms of their tax liability, and it allows them to use their real estate losses to offset their income. And we don't know if that's what Trump did here, but all of that was available to him. And these laws were actually put in place in the 1980s, Aaron, to keep real estate people from being unfairly taxed and suffering too much from market fluctuations. But what's happened with Trump and others like him is why some tax reform people think it needs to be reformed again.
Right. Of course, they say, you know, to invest in real estate, you need years and years of investing. You want people to do it through good times and bad. That's the argument for it. Obviously, it needs a reform. But beyond the real estate situation, how widespread is it, Tom? The practice of avoiding taxes, perfectly legally, by big corporations. Do people, do companies do what Trump did?
Well, it certainly looks like a lot of them do. There's a new report out this week from a couple of progressive groups out there that said that if you look at the Fortune 500 companies, 73% of them use offshore tax havens, for example. And in those tax havens, they've put $2.2 trillion in profits beyond the reach of Uncle Sam. Now, how much does that amount to? Well, their argument is if you could somehow claw this all back. Now, remember, these are liberal groups that promote that agenda. But if you could bring it all back here, they say it would automatically, at a 6% rate, put $718 billion extra dollars into the federal bank account. Aaron?
It is pretty stunning when you think about it. And that, of course, is something both Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton have said needs serious reform, which is companies parking all that money overseas. Thank you, Tom. And, you know, Donald Trump living so lavishly, it's hard to comprehend, but he was able to do it. It's sort of once you get rich enough, it seems people assume you'll eventually get back on your feet. You asked Eric Trump directly whether his father pays federal taxes. He said yes, but obviously there's still no proof. Is there any chance those returns come out?
I think it's very slim that the returns come out. They've gotten this far, and it's hard to imagine anything beyond what we've seen even over the weekend with the reporting from the New York Times on that huge, almost billion-dollar loss. The fact that he still hasn't done it, I don't see it changing. The one thing that I do find fascinating, though, Aaron, is just for the politics of this all, how the Clinton campaign is trying to use this not so much as the, see, he doesn't really get business, because people do sort of see Donald Trump as a lavish guy, and they know that he had ups and downs. He wrote a book called The Art of the Comeback.
Right.
But more of a patriotic issue, that how can somebody who wants to be president not pay taxes to support the military infrastructure, things that he's now saying are important and lacking?
And, of course, Mark, to that point that Dan is making, Trump has touted his use of the tax laws. He says this is what someone who's really smart and who knows how the system works would do. Here's what he said.
I have legally used the tax laws to my benefit and to the benefit of my company, my investors, and my employees. I have brilliantly used those laws.
I have brilliantly used those laws, Mark, he says. The lawyer who signed off on that particular tax return says, no, he was the one that did the work and figured out how to do it. Does this undermine Trump, or does this simply prove that he indeed can find smart, clever people to put in the right position?
Well, let me keep this short. It should undermine him. It should be devastating. It would kill any other politician at this point. It is not sticking to Donald Trump. Look, I think that his supporters, Aaron, are looking at him, and they see hope in him. They say, look, if he can do it, I can do it. They like the idea of him being the comeback kid, so to speak. And Donald Trump now can simply say, oh, I have used the tax system to my benefit, but now I work for you. That's his new line. We'll see if it continues. But right now, the lack of the release of his tax records hasn't hurt him.
Yep. All right. Thank you both very much. And next, the breaking news, a massive hurricane right now headed to Florida. Massive flooding, death across the Caribbean. Our report coming up. And outrage among some Latino voters after this remark last night.
Senator, you whipped out that Mexican thing again.